Happy holidays and welcome to the Asian American and Asian Research Institute's Fine Lecture Series online edition. My name is Anthony Wong, Program Coordinator of the Institute. Thank you very much for joining us tonight for our last lecture of the fall semester with Professor Hyunhee Park, joining us all the way from Korea on her book, Soju, A Global History, published by Cambridge University Press. The paperback was recently released in 2022 and is currently available for purchase online from Amazon for $44.99, or if you're interested in the ebook version for your Kindle, $33.99. The link is on Professor Park's talk webpage and also available in the chat. Hyunhee Park is professor of history at John Jay College of Criminal Justice at CUNY and the CUNY Graduate Center. A native of South Korea, Professor Park received her BA in Asian and Western History at Seoul National University, a master's degree in East Asian Studies at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, and a PhD in History at Yale University. Professor Park specializes in the history of cross-cultural contacts in East Asia and the Islamic world in Sino-Islamic contacts in particular, in the Mongol Empire and global history, focusing on information and knowledge transfers, including the transfers of geographical knowledge, foodways, and distillation technologies. She's authored Mapping the Chinese and Islamic Worlds, a Cross-Cultural Exchange in Pre-Modern Asia, and tonight's book, Soju, A Global History, and is the author of over 30 articles for academic journals and edited volumes. She also serves as coordinator of the Humanities and Justice Studies program and has taught several capstone courses for the HJS major, in addition to history courses including Chinese and Global History, Historiography, Research Methods, and Senior Seminars. Please welcome Professor Park.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us. And it's really my great honor and pleasure to be here with the Aari community. Thank you for this kind invitation. I published this book in English in 2021, and following that, I received encouragement to release a Korean version. So embracing this challenge, I personally undertook the translation process. So while it was a demanding task, the effort proved to be a rewarding endeavor. So I'm pleased to share that the Korean translation was successfully published in 2023, June this year, and it has been released very well. And I think this book suggests the intriguing intersection of Asian studies and Asian American studies, with a particular focus on soju. This iconic beverage not only serves as a symbol of cultural heritage that Korean and Asian Americans can take pride in, but it has also become a widely enjoyed spirit in the United States and beyond. Its increasing popularity and cultural significance underscore the importance of integrating these fields into a more comprehensive global Asian studies framework, reflecting the dynamic interplay of heritage, identity, and globalization. Many of you have been part of the Asian American and Asian Studies program might already be familiar with soju. Some may have even savored its unique taste in Korean restaurants. For those who haven't, soju is Korea's national spirit, a clear colorless liquor akin to vodka, as you can see in the screen. And thanks to the Korean wave, Hanyu, soju has become globally renowned, often promoted by K-pop icons like Psy and girl groups. As its popularity grows, it received attention in the media in the past few years. Unfortunately, when American journalists interviewed owners of Korean restaurants in several years ago, they failed to receive a clear answer. But everything has its history, often complicated ones like that for soju. I'm glad that I was able to publish this book before too long to solve many people's curiosity. After its publication in 2021, my book garnered some media attention, highlighting its impact and relevance. So right after the release, a Yahoo News article discussing soju relevance referenced my book, indicating its influence in the discourse on the traditional Korean spirit. And subsequently, a a New York Times piece on makgeolli, a traditional turbid wine different from soju, also drew on my book for insight, underscoring the breadth of its application in understanding Korean alcoholic beverages. And more recently, in September, I don't know if you have heard about this. So I was interviewed by an LA journalist that there was a new launch of a new brand of soju. This article that interviewed me spotlighted Korean rap star and Los Angeles native Jay Park's launch of his soju brand, One Soju, in the United States. Targeting a younger demographic, this initiative seeks to expand soju's allure beyond its traditional Korean base, reaching out not only to Korean American and Asian American communities, but also to a broader international audience. And I value this article for its concise and informative approach and offering the readers a snapshot of soju's evolving story, to which I was able to contribute. So I'm pleased that my book contributes effectively to discussions about soju and other alcoholic beverages in Korea. However, I want to clarify upfront that my book's primary aim was to explore the rich history of soju dating back to the pre-modern period. So here is the table of contents of my book. I was particularly struck by the rich global dimensions of soju's history. While recognized as a Korean spirit, its origins and the spread of related distillation technology trace back to ancient times in Eurasia and beyond, with further evolution in the modern era through new technologies. In contemplating the most suitable section of my book to present at the Ari community, considered like, discussing maybe the development of soju as a unique Korean liquor during the Joseon period in chapter 4, starting from the 15th century. But I thought it might be more interesting to share my transnational perspective, encompassing Eurasian and global history in the context of Korean history and global history. So I will focus on the theme soju and Korea in global cross-cultural exchanges, hopefully covering its development in the 21st century in the wider world, including the U.S. So as time is limited, let me focus on the key points of my book, tracing soju's journey through various historical periods. So the rise of soju during the Mongol period and the local development in Korea in the early modern period to the present, the rise of modern industrial soju in 20th and 21st century. But before that, first of all, let me first start with my academic journey, how I got involved in this study about Korean culture, and many people asking me about this. So actually, my doctoral dissertation, later published as my first book, explored medieval contexts and exchanges between the Chinese, East Asian, and Islamic worlds, utilizing geographic and cartographic information. So if you are interested in old maps and broader Eurasian context, please have a look at this book too. So while preparing this book, my research focus gradually expanded to encompass other kinds of information and technology transfers. At the point, never in my wildest imagination did I suspect that I would write my next book on the history of alcoholic drinks and Korea. But I became so intrigued by the topic of technology in general and by the cross-cultural context and transfers involved in the development of soju within the context of global history. And it was Dr. Paul Buer, a renowned expert on the Mongol period, who first introduced me to this topic in the history of alcohol, especially to the history of spirits, distilled liquors. And Dr. Buer was working with Dr. Ana Valenzuela, an expert on Mexican spirits, in their collaborative project about comparative investigation of distilled technologies. Starting with possible influences of the Asian spheres on distillation in Mexico. So Dr. Buer has examined the key role that the Mongols played during the age of their massive empire in disseminating improved distillation technology widely in Eurasia. He also argued that the Mongols also created an environment in which a variety of cultures could produce their own distilled liquors using local ingredients. They invited me to investigate the case of Korean soju, and so doing so gave me the opportunity to write my book. So I'm so glad that I was able to write it as a monograph so that people can use it to study further the history of alcohol in Korea and other cultural elements in pre-modern Korea and other parts of Asia. So these topics about culture need further English language publications when many academic fields have this global tongue. I was worried that Western scholars such as Joseph Needham and his colleagues have not treated Korean soju for their very comparative research about the history of distillation in their magnificent volume, Science and Civilization in China. So this was because few studies on soju were available in Western languages. Although there are some old Korean studies in Korean, so I was able to study the new topic, the history of liquors in Korea, thanks to my collaboration with these scholars. But I had to study from the very primary sources because there haven't been really serious studies on this topic. And another advantage helped me to study Korean history from a global perspective, the importance of the Mongol Empire in this study. Recent studies have shed new light on the history of the Mongol Empire in the current concurrent epoch in Korean history, namely the Goryeo dynasty deserves an equivalently significant re-evaluation. So the English Latin name Korea is from this dynasty, Goryeo dynasty. There have been many studies about the Goryeo dynasty inside Korea, but very few publications are available in English. And also, very few studies have focused on the cultural exchanges between the Mongol Empire and Korea. So I believe my book is the first work to do so and hope to promote more studies in this direction. So now, let me give you some highlights of the chapters in my book, starting with the Mongol roots of soju. Searching for soju's origins, I should lead you into the vast, complex world of pre-modern Eurasia, because soju is one of the distilled spirits that began to be popularized there from the Mongol period of the 13th and 14th centuries. Unlike the production of fermented alcohols like wine and beer, whose fermentation ideas could first have been observed in nature, distilled liquor production was made possible only by the development of a chemical technology called distillation. Distillation is a technique used to separate alcohol content from water and other contents using boiling and condensing or even freezing in the northern part of Eurasia. Distillation typically requires not only the calculation of different boiling points for a variety of ingredients, but also the development of distilling apparatus, colloquially called still. For example, here is a still for French cognac spirits only produced in cognac francs. This is a cross-sectional view of the still. The rising vapor after boiling is condensed by the water, and the resulting liquid of higher alcohol content can then be led into a separate receiving pot. Thanks to experts like Joseph Needham, we know that people in Asia developed stills different from European pot stills much earlier. Prior to mass-produced industrial soju of the 20th century, Koreans also made soju using traditional Korean distillation methods. That's by distilling fermented rice wine using Korean distillation apparatus called soju gori. This is quite similar to some of traditional stills used for distillation in other parts of Eurasia, particularly those of China and Mongolia. Like Joseph Needham and other experts have categorized these as Asian type stills, different from European pot stills. So in fact, the origins of the distilled liquors for widespread consumption have become a topic for heated debate within a larger context of world history. So in these first three chapters, I explored their roots and transfers by examining all the existing theories to provide a convincing and updated assumption. So recently, scholars have argued the likelihood of multiple independent inventions of the idea of distillation in at least the ancient Near East, in China, and even India. There are heated debates still going on. And several societies developed distillation ideas in the ancient period, but they used it to do such things as distill herbal alcohol and perfume or mercury, rather than making drinking liquor. Intriguingly, we began to have a surge of documents about distilled liquor from the Mongol period, starting with China and Korea in the 13th and 14th centuries. So all other distilled spirits like vodka, whiskey, or brandy have a similar history that go back to the late medieval period. But the earliest documentary evidence for the distilled liquors is from the 14th century Chinese documents with the earliest archaeological evidence. So these Chinese documents testify to the rapid spread of distilled liquor in Eurasia from the Mongol period, not before. And so these include Soju in Chinese and Soju and Arak. So the word Soju is the Korean reading of Chinese Soju, the roast liquor, cooked liquor. But we should look at another distilled liquor called Arak that began to rise along with Soju during the Mongol period and were transferred to Korea about the same time. And what is Arak? You can see Arak everywhere in Eurasia. So Arak is from the Arabic word Arak, sweat or perspiration, essential drops created by vapor during distillation. My book's readers will be intrigued to learn that distilled liquors were also widely called Arak in many parts of the Afro-Eurasian world, including China, Korea, and Japan, not to mention the Middle East, from where the term Arak originated in the first place. And if you were interested in soju, you have seen a modern soju brand with this name, Arak. So this shows close connections among these liquors in their origins. And the rapid spread of the distilled liquors, often known by their universal name Arak, throughout most Eurasia, occurred in the Mongol period in the 13th and 14th centuries. And this strongly suggests that the spread of these distilled spirits is related to the Mongols. So chapter one of my book delves into how Soju and Arak intermingled and evolved in China during the Mongol period. The Chinese had been producing distilled alcohol from grain fermented liquors to some extent during the Song Dynasty from like 11th, 12th century, using both native and foreign distillation technologies. The Mongols, after conquering southern China, embraced these techniques to distill their favored milk fermented drink, pumis, a crucial beverage for their culture. So this move by the Mongols likely accelerated the spread of distilled spirits throughout China, leading to the intermingling of Soju and Arak, ultimately based on fermented grains. So it's like a typical story, like there are group of people who really liked it, and then they contributed to the spread of this, even though they didn't invent this. It was the Mongols. So understanding this complex history of distilled spirits was essential before tracing the transfer of soju to Korea. So the goal was to piece together the intricate puzzle of this liquor's evolution, which my book attempts to do so. And so, actually, I was honored that an expert in Chinese liquor included my work in their list of the best 5 books on Chinese alcohol and drinking culture. And as we navigate through this rich and layered history, we gain not just insights into the origins of soju, but also a deeper understanding of the cultural exchanges that shaped our world. And the next chapters of my book explore the fascinating journey of Shaozhou and Arak from the Mongol Empire to the Korean Peninsula during the Goryeo Dynasty. The transfer of spirits from the Mongol Empire to Goryeo even served as a well-documented case of the spread of spirits at the time. So in this book, I argue that we could use this Korean case to explore the further diffusion of similar distilled spirits in the broader area under the Mongol influence. So let me explain the situation in Korea at the time. The Korean Peninsula was ruled by the Goryeo Dynasty, and from here, so the Western name Korea, I told you, is derived from this dynasty name. And I think those who study Korean history are familiar with the modern period or Joseon dynasty. But of course, you can see these earlier dynasties in Korea. And the Korea period is particularly rich in its contact with the wider world. And of course, the earlier kingdoms did that too. Like many other regimes in Eurasia, Korea was first conquered by the Mongols in the 13th century and became part of the Mongol Empire. It had close political and cultural exchanges with that, not as like conquered, like a territory, but it became pretty independent. It was a kind of vassal state. And even as a son-in-law state, because the Mongol princes and the kings married the princes of the Mongol Empire. So for example, some like Korean monarchs like King Chungseon took advantage of this complex status to ensure Korea's continuing independence as a state and to promote its privilege within the Mongol Empire at large. So this opened the way to a wide range of cross-cultural interactions, from the stationing of the Mongol soldiers in the Korean Peninsula and on Jeju Island, to trade, to court relations and intermarriages. So these situations created opportunities for the exchange, laying the foundations for soju's development. Such a process is not exclusively exclusive to alcohol. We see similar patterns in various cultural artifacts, even other kinds of Korean foods like meat. A part of exchanges, meat eating culture was introduced by the Mongols too, because Buddhism was a dominant religion in Korea period. The people did not eat much meat, you can understand. But the Mongols' meat eating culture was transferred to Korea and began to spread across the Korean Peninsula from the Mongol period, along with the revival of hunting culture. So this change in culinary culture could have boosted distilled alcohol consumption with a strong alcoholic percentage that worked better with meat. So the famous Korean barbecue, like bulgogi, galbi, could be one like Mongol legacy. These new cultural elements also include new philosophical ideas like Neo-Confucianism and science like astronomy and geography, like this famous world map, including Africa, made first in China and Korea in the 14th century. So in this way, soju provides an excellent vehicle for understanding the extent of Eurasian influence on Korea and Korea's place in Eurasia under so-called Pax Mongolica in the Mongol peace in the 13th and 14th centuries. As for distillation technology transfer, I argue in this book that because a simple Mongolian steel, Mongolian style steel, and not the complicated Chinese steel, was introduced to Korea by the Mongols, it diffused across the Korean peninsula far more speedily than if other types of more complex technology had been involved. So, but the documentation from the Goryeo period is sparse, with only three or four extant references to distilled liquors. So it's in the subsequent Joseon period where we find more substantial evidence supporting this technology transfer and the evolution of soju as we know it today. So chapter four, now we briefly introduce the story of soju in Korea in Joseon period, Korea's last pre-modern dynasty. So in this Joseon period, soju not only became deeply embedded in Korean culture, but also underwent significant localization in terms of production methods and cultural practices. So this era marked a time when soju rapidly spread across the Korean peninsula, cementing its role as a pivotal element in Korea's alcoholic beverage, building upon the foundations laid in the late Goryeo period. The Joseon era saw soju's integration into various aspects of Korean life. The royal court, recognizing soju's value, began using soju for both diplomatic gift giving and medical purposes. Even establishing a dedicated bureau for its distillation. The official endorsement had a profound impact, extending soju's reach into everyday life as households began to produce soju as a tribute, thereby embedding it in the domestic brewing culture known as gayangju. Intriguingly, this contrasts with the Chinese approach, like China's approach at the time, where industrial-scale distillers were more common. In Korea, soju evolved in a more like a grassroots manner, as evidenced by its frequent mention in cookbooks and medical texts. These sources provided recipes and medical applications, indicating soju's growing prominence in the Korean society. For instance, during the hot summer months, soju became a preferred substitute in ancestral worship rituals, where fermented wines like cheongju, rice wine, were prone to spoilage. The island of Jeju, you can see it's famous for now the tourism, it has a very strong Mongol legacy, and it has a humid climate. It's a notable example where soju became the primary alcoholic beverage, as the preservation of fermented drinks was challenging. So in fact, I was so intrigued by the fact that distilled liquors such as Korean soju have been used in social, medicinal, and spiritual practices, and even used to produce hand sanitizers when the COVID-19 pandemic has worsened and become prolonged. Some of these sources from the Joseon period help us understand that the first steel type distillation apparatus spread in Korea is a simple Mongolian style distillation technique brought by the Mongols. So there's soju's population, soju's production spread quickly thanks to the simple Mongolian style distillation technique. And I actually found a diary-style record written in the late 17th century, and which provides a wonderful hint. The author of the memoir, Lee Ji-hang, was adrift at sea, poor guy. But he wanted to have water and to survive, and he reported, he tried to distill seawater to drink as if he were distilling soju by this boiling pot method. So he describes how he like put the seawater in a pot, closed the pot lid upside down, as you can see in the diagram, and received only half of the bottle of distilled water, which dripped from the lid of the pot, and indeed it tasted plain, not salty. So in time, the tools to make soju evolved until the original simple form morphed into the relatively complicated steel called gori, as you can see these later, the versions of the steel. Some sources also pointed out whenever the consumption of soju grew large enough to cause problems for the Korean economy, which was possible given the use of rice, Korea's most basic staple as its main ingredient. So indeed, because of this, the government issued prohibitions during droughts against alcohol drinks, particularly soju. And we also see this kind of alcohol ban in other cultures, like US in early 20th century. So at the time, this happened many times. And in addition, official documents and medical books also report side effects caused by the abusive consumption of soju, also very common nowadays. So while documentary evidence demonstrates an ongoing process of soju localization within Korea during the Joseon Dynasty 5 centuries, it likewise shows that Koreans also integrated with other societies to varying degrees through soju. Soju was regularly transported as official gifts or trade goods through the course of the Ming and Qing dynasties in China, the Tokugawa shogunate in Japan, and the kingdom of Ryukyu on Okinawa. As Europeans began to expand into Asian waters, Korea also gradually opened to the world at large. Europeans traveling to Korea observed heavy drinking, especially strong alcohol, which probably meant soju. So this rich history during the Joseon era set the stage for soju's transformation in the 20th century, eventually leading to its status as Korea's national drink. And its important transformation, the evolution of soju during the 20th century, laid the foundation for the flowering of the current soju culture in the 21st century. This transformation was both directly and indirectly affected by enormous changes that are the hallmarks of the modern period in global history, which include the scientific revolution beginning in the 18th century, industrialization, modernization, colonialism, and globalization. I discussed it in three different phases. The first phase, the transportation to consider, is the modernization of the soju distillation industry, which involved the introduction of new technologies and methods during the colonial rule of Korea by Imperial Japan from 1910 to 1945. So during this period, the traditional soju, according to distillation methods and recipes made conventional during Joseon time, declined gradually as Japanese companies introduced and popularized a modern industrial form for Korean consumers. Instead of using a traditional small distillation apparatus like soju gori, the new industrial form of soju introduced by the Japanese has used a continuous steel for mass production at low cost in large factories that innovators in European societies developed during the 18th century and later introduced to Japan in the late 19th century. So the photo V is photo of an industrial soju factory in Jeju Island in 1943. And this one is a photo of ethanol distilled columns in Korea in recent years. The second transformation occurred amidst the new environment of rapid economic development and state building that defined Korea, South Korea in particular, between its independence in 1945 and its realization of developed nation status in the late 20th century. During this half century, Koreans faced many chaotic and difficult situations that presented them with major challenges, including the Korean War, rapid modernization, and industrialization led by a dictatorial government, followed by a fiercely determined democratization movement. The Korean government supported factory manufactured industrial soju made from potatoes instead of its traditional ingredient, rice, because it lacked grain. Only in the 1980s did the government begin to promote traditional distilled soju as minsokju, literally a national folk liquor, part of its policy of promoting national culture. This encouraged a revived traditional soju whose consumption had declined during the era of Japanese rule. The traditional soju available to us nowadays is the one revived at this time. In the third and most recent transformation between the late 20th and the early 21st centuries, a globalizing economy created unprecedented connections between soju producers and virtually every part of the world. This represents a radical form of multiple cross-cultural transforms between beyond the Korean culture. In particular, the 21st century has witnessed a remarkable global expansion of soju, largely fueled by the Korean wave Hanryu and the worldwide popularity of Korean cuisine. Soju exports have surged, reaching out not only East Asia and traditional intercultural contact zones like North America and Europe, but also regions with historically less interactions with Korea, such as Africa and other regions. So this internationalization can be attributed to three main factors: the global rise of Korean cuisine, the widespread influence of Korean popular culture, including dramas, television programs, movies, and K-pop games, and soju's affordability and mass production. Korean restaurants, many run by Korean immigrants, have played a pivotal role in popularizing soju, the Korean dishes globally, with items like kimchi, bulgogi, and bibimbap becoming household names. Soju, often accompanying these dishes, has benefited from this culinary spread. Its pairing with Korean meat dishes echoes the complementary relationship seen between Japanese sake and sushi. Governmental initiatives and the Korean wave have further amplified soju's presence globally, with the Korean dramas often featuring social scenes with soju. Additionally, the low alcohol content of industrial soju has made it more accessible in markets like the US, where it can be sold under regular alcohol licenses, much like wine. And I heard that Korean Americans contributed this kind of changes. And even at the same time, even Korean makers like Americans grown up in Brooklyn like boldly appropriated the Korean spirit, leading to innovations in soju that could compete in Korea and abroad. So this is Toki soju, rabbit soju, and it's very popular even in Korea, and actually the factory is also in Korea too. So this kind of recent transformation during the past century catalyzed the development of today's soju as a new global brand. So let me point out that the soju that made Korean soju famous globally in the 21st century is this mass-produced industrial soju. It has less alcohol, only around 20%, than a traditional brand with more than 45% alcohol. The soju made of rice in a traditional distillation way has a smoother taste than industrial soju, according to Soju Gourmet. But these industrial soju factories have also made their effort to improve the taste. Where? Then I think we can also like ask some fundamental questions, like what is soju? And I just discussed the questions in my book about the identity of soju and the meaning of soju identifiers as like such identifiers as tradition and modernity that have been regularly applied to this ever changing spirit. So actually, different approaches to interpreting the consequences of soju's transformation have led to debates about like what constitutes like traditional soju. And so, like, simply put, like, can we call modern forms of soju or even self-consciously traditional ones like authentic? So actually, the answer in this book is yes, because I traced its history back to the ancient period, starting with this distillation technology and for its development. It really involves very complicated ones. And so, like, modern form is in this long historical flow. So, but some people, of course, can don't have to agree. And so, despite the discussion, soju has successfully carved out its niches on the global stage, blending tradition with modernity and showcasing the flexibility and adaptability of this iconic Korean spirit. So this search for soju's origins can extend even further into the past, through the Middle Ages, antiquity, and beyond, and into the future as global soju companies continue to study people's cultural attitudes and consumption patterns and respond with experiments in ingredients and technologies that try to adapt soju to the diverse and changing tastes of people all over the world. Instead of stopping at the case of Korea, in the last chapter of this book, I examined two cases that stimulate discussions of transfers of distilled liquor in a global context. The case of shochu in Japan and the case of tequila in Mexico. But I have no time to talk about this, so I will answer if you have any further questions about this during the Q&A. So just in conclusion, I hope that this exploration of soju's complex history has not only been enlightening, but also illustrative of the deep connections between Korean history and Korean-American history. The evolution of soju is a vivid example of how cultural practices and products traverse borders and generations, shaping societies and forging new identities. It exemplifies the resilience and adaptability of cultural heritage as it flows from Korean roots to global branches, including the vibrant Korean-American communities. This journey of soju from its origins in Korea and broader Eurasia to its embrace in the United States and beyond mirrors the broader narrative of Korean immigrants and their descendants who have continually negotiated their identity and heritage in a global context and developed their own culture based on the tradition. As a Korean, my aim in presenting this objective global history was not only to enlighten, but also to kindle a deeper interest in the rich tapestry of Korean culture and history, and how it interweaves with the experiences and contributions of Korean Americans. Korean Americans have played a pivotal role in the distribution and popularization of Korean food and culture in the United States. So their contributions span various facets, from culinary innovation to the cultural exchange. And my book didn't delve into the topic of Korean Americans more deeply, but I believe this would be an important topic to explore further. So thank you so much for your attention. And I eagerly anticipate any questions you may have. And just in closing, I would like to share a fascinating discovery from a Korean newspaper article of Marvel Comics. You see some of the faces here from like Marvel, the comics, like Avengers. So they made this poster depicting a scene of barbecue and spirits. So this scene reminiscent of late Joseon period artworks that I have encountered in Korean museum, which is in my book jacket. So vividly captures the enduring cultural significance of food and drink in Korean society. So it also reflects the continuity and evolution of these cultural elements from Korean history into Korean American experiences, reminding us of the rich shared heritage that continue to thrive and adapt in our globalized world. Thank you.
Thank you very much for a fascinating talk, Professor Park, and congratulations on the Korean translation of your publication.
Thank you.
Is it available in the States or only in Korea right now?
Oh, I know that some Korean books would become available in Amazon ultimately, but I don't know how soon. Let me see. Yeah, it would be nice. Yeah.
Our attendee said, could you please share some of the primary documents you have used for this book? And are they in different languages besides Korean? Thank you.
Oh, yeah. Thank you. That's really kind of academic questions about how and also the research methods. Yes, so definitely. So, when I got intrigued to this topic and agreed to join the project Global Spirit research by my colleagues, I thought there would be some Korean books and articles that I could easily use. So because this is not my primary research topic, and I thought it would be more like introducing the current research done in Korean languages. But once I started this project, I was so surprised, and there were not many studies that really delved into the primary sources deeply. And so available works only like recycled some of the earlier works. So I had to trace all the sources, like major secondary sources and the primary sources used by the previous studies. And because I'm a historian, and without relying on historical sources, I cannot make any argument. And it took some time because really many recent works recycled earlier ones. But after certain research, I found that there are primary sources, and they are very valuable sources that really needed further investigations. And so for about like the rise of Soju in Goryeo dynasty and late Goryeo period, we have pieces of evidence in the official chronicle of the Goryeo period, like history, official history of Goryeo-sa. And also we have poems. And to compare the rise of Soju with the Korean alcohols developed in before the Mongol period, I had to study the earlier Korean sources. There are not many documents, I mean, compared to those of Chinese history, which have really tons. Yeah, so many documentary evidence for many aspects. But still, we have a good number of sources that I was able to examine and compare with and then trace the evolution of alcohols enjoyed by the Korean people. And then the very important thing is that, and also about the history of Korean alcoholic drinks in the Joseon period, from late 14th century. We have many documents because many people in Joseon period left official histories, different kinds of official histories, and also many literary works, poems, and like miscellaneous works, and all various kinds of documents. So actually the chapter 4 about the Joseon dynasty, like how Korean soju developed and became localized. I thought I could write a very short chapter, but I found many sources, and instead of using them like comprehensively, I had to really pick the most important ones and make the most important points based on those sources. And the most important point I think I didn't make it during my talk is that so we know the Mongol period, the distilled liquor spread worldwide. We see the first documentation of distilled liquor and distillation technique apply to drinking like alcoholic drinks from the 14th century. But after that, the distilled liquors began to appear in the East and West gradually. But it's difficult to find the primary sources that help us trace the, like, for example, like westward transition. We just see like, oh, suddenly in Iran and probably in like Eastern Europe, like close to Russia, we began to see like the rise of vodka. And any connections with this like Mongol like a spread of this liquor? And we cannot exactly say that, but it's very, very likely. And the case of the transfer of this liquor from China, under Mongol rule, to Korea gives a lot of good pieces of evidence that help us trace this, because we see like really the two countries were connected, and we see and many other things were transferred to the Korean peninsula too. We have many more sources from the 16th, 17th centuries, the modern period, in like worldwide. But for the pre-modern period, it's really difficult to find like sufficient sources that help us like trace everything. And especially for the cultural items like soju and food, it's even more difficult. But we can work like a detective. We can try to figure out the most reliable and relevant sources. And also using comparative approaches, we can see that the piece of the evidence for the transfer of soju and rice and development of soju in Korea is relatively well documented compared to other historical spirits. And so I argued in the book's conclusion that we have to look at the history of soju and shaojo and Asian spirits to understand, newly understand the history of global spirits. So there, spirits are very, popular, whiskey, vodka, brandy, but actually, even though they are important, in general, the history of global spirits need like further studies. And my colleagues working on like Western spirits, like vodka, all agreed that we have to study this more, focusing on this technological perspective and also the like cultural aspect. And so this case gives good pieces of evidence, and it's because in the pre-modern period before the European expansion, we find more documented, rich documentation about the culture in Asian part. Because there were a lot of exchanges and the context among different Asian countries. I believe many of you have heard about the Silk Road. Silk Road is like a symbolic, this really kind of existed as like trade routes that connected many Asian countries in pre-modern Eurasia. Like silk was very important product too, that was liked by the Westerners, and it's not just silk, but many other things were exchanged. And I argue that other cultural items like drink, like food and soju in medicine, in many, many things were also transferred and exchanged and developed further in different local areas in interesting way. And soju's history gives some interesting examples for this kind of context. And so if you look at my book, you can find more primary sources. And in the bibliography, because I wrote this book as an academic book, I separate like primary source, bibliography, the reference corner, and then the secondary sources. And about the languages, I had, because I studied the context between Chinese and Islamic world, I can read Arabic slowly, and also I can read Chinese and Japanese. And So I was able to read those key primary sources scattered in different languages. And for some sources of the languages I cannot read, like Persian, I got help from my colleagues.
In regards to, well, you tonight's talk, you discuss primarily Korea and China in terms of shoujo and baijiu. Did you do any comparisons at all between soju and sake? You know.
Oh yeah, yeah, I did that in chapter six. Yeah, so today, yeah, because of the time limit, I wasn't able to talk more about that. But it's very interesting comparison because. You know, Japanese food was very famous and very popular in worldwide. And for Japanese alcohol, people always think like about this sake. It's actually this is a fermented rice wine, very similar to the rice wine that developed before the rise of soju in Korea. And so its alcohol percentage is much lower. And then Japan was not directly connected to the Mongol Empire, so it seems like the Mongols didn't influence Japan with like shoujo and distilled liquor directly. And but it's possible always like I'm as a historian, I'm talking about the kind of the. Like the transfers and then situation support, testify to by the sources, but we always we can imagine that probably there were more like interactions, yeah, that were not documented. But anyway, the distilled liquor began to appear in Japan, Japanese islands, from like 16th century, much later, and. Then yeah, I also trace like how distilled liquor could be transferred to Japan, like from like possible routes from Korea, from China, and also from like the South, from probably Europeans or like Southeast Asia, Thailand, Ryukyu, who introduced this spirit. But interesting thing is, unlike Korea, where the soju became very popular so quickly. Shochu, the Japanese distilled liquor, didn't get very popular because, and I argue that actually Japan in the early modern period, in Edo period, they had very systematic system to distribute sake, like a fermented liquor. So they didn't have to worry about the preservation of these alcoholic drinks. So the soju was and distilled liquor, they are really kind of great invention as a, like alcohol that can be preserved for longer time. But if in Japan, Japanese people were able to drink like sake easily, all different kinds of sake. Yeah, I think like yeah they so it sake became like more popular in Japan. But we can find some references to like soju, and I also mentioned in my talk that in the Joseon period, in early modern period, the Korean the Joseon the kings sent many bottles of soju to other countries like Japan. So Japanese we have some references that Japanese had this soju or shochu in Tokyo, in the like central part of Japan, but it didn't get really popular. Yeah, but later but actually the Japanese brought this machine from the Europe to mass produce like shochu, and then they introduced this technology to Korea. So that's how. The Korean soju actually had another change in this terms of like production and technology, and the Japanese also developed the shochu continuously. And in 1980s and 90s, there was a boom in Japanese shochu, so different kind of shochu. If you go to Asian market, Korean market, or Japanese market, you can also see a section of Japanese shochu, not just sake, but different kinds of like beautiful bottles of shochu too.
Thank you again, Professor Park, for a wonderful talk. You can purchase Soju, A Global History online from Amazon. The link is on Professor Park's talk webpage. I also dropped it in the chat several times. Please, holidays are coming up, so you can purchase a copy available on paperback as well as ebook for your Kindle. And with that, enjoy the rest of your Friday evening. Have a wonderful holiday season. Remember to be upstander if you see a fellow person in need. Thank you very much, Professor Park, for joining us all the
Thank
way
you so
from
much.
Korea. I hope to see you soon during the spring semester. And yep, everybody else, if we don't see you soon, Happy New Year and join us again in the spring. Thank you very much. Have a
Thank
good
you
weekend.
so much.
Bye
Bye.
bye.
See you
Good night.
soon.